Hello and welcome to Christian Living Australia. My name is Abel and we are a Christian YouTube channel that has the main purpose of researching books of the Bible. We're looking into archaeological discoveries that's been made over the last few decades. We're looking into biblical facts and we're also bringing the Bible, the stories of the Bible to you in a visual presentation for you to read and to watch and to learn. Now, my co-host, Margarita, is not going to be taking part in the videoing today, but she's responsible for the presentation and the editing to make a masterpiece for you to keep and to watch. Please have your books ready, sit closely, listen. We're going to have a wonderful time on the last part of Acts 16. And we're looking into the English Standard Version as our translation to do this. Talk to you a bit later. Let's close our eyes in prayer. Heavenly Father, You've called us to grow in grace, to increase our understanding of Jesus, and to develop a close and intimate relationship with You. Lord, this is what we desire to do, and we pray we may come to know You more and more each day. Thank You, Father, for the Bible, which is written to help us understand Your word of truth. And thank You for the indwelling Holy Spirit who has promised to guide us in the way that we should go. We pray that we may learn to walk in spirit and truth so that we may mature in our Christian faith as we study the Bible and learn to live godly in Christ Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's continue with verse 25. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's bonds were unfastened. You just listened to the audio reading of the verses 25 and 26 of Acts 16. So let's start and see what happens to Paul. Before we continue, I want to briefly bring back some of the aspects from previous recording about where Paul and Silas was witnessing Jesus, which was not one of the recognized deities from the Roman government, which caused some trouble among them, and also about Paul, who cast out a demon from a slave girl and whose masters became very upset because she doesn't have the ability to do fortune telling anymore and so not could make no money for them. So let's continue on. Just with that in mind, let's continue on with verse 25. We see that Paul and Silas are in jail and they don't know what's going to happen next. But one truth is they know that God is in control, and with that they don't have to fear anything. We see that Paul references that this suffering in Philippi in his letter in Thessalonians. We'll see it later. If you want to, go and read 1 Thessalonians 2 verse 2. That's explain it to you. Now, in the same letter, he also tells the Thessalonians to rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. That is in 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 16 to 18. It's a well-known verse. It's a very promising verse, and it gives us confidence to continue on with life where people feel trapped or depressed in their life. And we'll see also that Paul tells the Colossians that as Jesus suffered to offer salvation for the world, he as Paul willingly suffer to spread Jesus' offer of salvation. Look in Colossians 1 verse 24. We also notice that Luke, for biblical scholars, inserted himself into the narrative of Paul and Silas here in Acts 16 verse 10. Now, the writing here grew more personal and detailed as we go on further. Looking in verses 25 to 34 again, you can see it feels impersonal and summarized. That doesn't mean that this part isn't scripture altogether. Paul and Silas, well, we think that Paul and Silas probably told Luke what happened with them in jail, and the Holy Spirit actually directed Luke to include this part in his book. Now, verse 35, which we'll see later, returned to be more personal and also more like a first-hand style of Luke. In verse 26 and 27, we see that Paul and Silas has responded by singing praises to God and praying while all the other prisoners were listening to them. Verses 16 to 25. Some archaeological facts about the place of Macedonia, this is where Paul and Silas are. It was known for its earthquakes, but what standing out about this tremor is that it's very unique for the following facts. The building doesn't collapse on the people, and none of the prisoners are harmed in this earthquake. But we'll see that all the doors and chains came loose. The doors opened and chains just fell off. And strangely enough, all the prisoners stay inside. Nobody decided to escape jail. So, reading from verse 27. When the jailer woke and saw that the prison doors were open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, supposing that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul cried out with a loud voice, "Do not harm yourself, for we are all here." Okay, viewers, we just finished listening to the audio Bible verse of 27 and 28. I now want to take you back to Acts 12, one of the previous podcasts where we heard the story about Peter, who was imprisoned by Herod Agrippa the First. And I think we experience the same situation here as what we have with Paul, just with the outcome is slightly different. We know that Agrippa imprisoned Peter with basically intent to execute him, but God intervened and sent an angel who led Peter out of the prison. He basically walked straight through the guards out. Because they let the prisoner go free, Agrippa had the guards executed. And so verse 3, Acts 12, verse 3 to 19 again. Please, in your free time, go and read it. It's very interesting. Now, back to this current case here, where we have Paul in the prison and Silas in the prison. The jailer in Philippi realizes when this freak earthquake has opened all the cellar doors and also unloosened the chains of the prisoners. He was so frightened and scared that he prepared to kill himself. Reason because he is responsible for the prisoners of the Roman post, and they are very scared what could happen to them. I think the jailer realized or come to the conclusion that a sword is kinder than what a city magistrates would do to him because of his irresponsibility, and they might even crucify him. Now, Paul and Silas, if we look back at verse 26, have been singing the hymns and were praying to God while the other prisoners listening. At verse 25, Perhaps we could say the saying here is that the word spread a sense of peace, no one leaves, and the jailer is spared. Reading from verse 29. And the jailer called for lights and rushed in, and trembling with fear, he fell down before Paul and Silas. Verse 30. Then he brought them out and said, Sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, Believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household. And they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house. Hi viewers, we continue on with our study and we're looking at verse 29 to 32 of Acts 16. We just listened to the audio recordings. Let's continue. We see that Paul's and Silas's faith in God definitely saved the life of this jailer and provide for the eternal life of the family and possibly also save lives of the other prisoners who would have been hunted down if they wanted to fled, as they trying to fled. It's not unreasonable to assume that at least some of the prisoners accepted faith in Christ during this situation, because seeing that the Holy Spirit is all present there, that is what happens when the Holy Spirit revives, is people accept Christ as their Savior. The missionaries' willingness to stay in the prison, even though they were placed there illegally, ensures that they can call, they can return to Philippi after this. Read that in Acts 20 from the previous podcast. You can recall it from a previous podcast. So Acts 20 verse 1 to 2 and also verse 6. I think this whole incident here, and I think you would probably wholeheartedly agree, it strengthens the nascent church and it becomes also that one of Paul's, and did well become one of Paul's greatest blessings in this time. Philippians 4 verse 10. Reading on from verse 33. And he took them the same hour of the night and washed their wounds, and he was baptized at once, he and his family. Then he brought them up into his house and set food before them, and he rejoiced along with his entire household that he had believed in God. Viewers, yes, next verses on the line is verses 33 to 34. We just listened to the audio, so let's see what the baptism is. We see that happened here is that the jailer took Paul and Silas to his place, his living, and he washed them up, he cleaned them off the blood of their wounds, and they then baptized him and his family. Now, we know from the past that baptism doesn't save. It doesn't actively forgive every sin in the past. It's basically, a baptism is an outward obedience to the word of God. It's a picture of the washing away of one's sins, that or the sins that people experience when they give those sins to Jesus to forgive. Please read Acts 22 verse 16. It also represents the dying of one's old nature, sinful nature to be specific, burying the old person with Christ's death and burial in a cave, and then rising again, regenerated, renewed, and restored to a new life. For more reading, go to Colossians 2 verse 12. We see that Paul and Silas here no longer bear the blood of their shameful, unfair punishment. And also, secondly, that the jailer's family is washed off their sins in Jesus' blood, and they are freed of the punishment they justly deserve. Like every one of us else before became to Christ deserved the punishment of Jesus. we see here that that is the first recording of Paul being imprisoned, but please bear in mind that it is far from the last one. In his first imprisonment in Rome, Paul is willing to bring the message of reconciliation with God to the Caesar's household, firstly, Philippians 4 verse 22, to the imperial guard as well, Philippians 1 verse 13, and he also writes in his letters to the Philippians, Ephesians, Colossians, and Philemon about the reconciliation with God. We also, there's another imprisonment that Paul went through, and he writes about that to his in his personal letter to Timothy, in 2 Timothy 1 verse 8. So we can see Paul has quite experience of imprisonments in his missionary life. We also see that Paul knew from the beginning that he would suffer severely in his ministry. Acts 9 verse 16 tells us more about that, when persecution comes. But he doesn't let this slow him down. He is determined, he is fired up, and he's doing the will of God, because the Holy Spirit is leading him to go through all his places and spread the gospel of the good news. Reading from verse 35. But when it was day, the magistrates sent the police, saying, "Let those men go." And the jailer reported these words to Paul, saying, "The magistrates have sent to let you go. Therefore, come out now and go in peace." Now, viewers, we also see that the Roman police actually arrived with a message to ask people that Paul and Silas should leave the town. They want to get rid of these two men. But what they don't realize is that because they never asked them, is that Paul and Silas are Roman citizens. And that is quite a strong point of basis for Paul and Silas to stand on. Acts 16 verse 37. What should have happened at most is that they should have been held under house arrest, at least until a legal trial could start. And it's been discovered by biblical scholars, not only were they abused and imprisoned illegally, but it's Roman custom and law that you cannot just force a Roman citizen out of a Roman city at that time. Reading continue from verse 37. But Paul said to them, "They have beaten us publicly, uncondemned, men who are Roman citizens, and have thrown us into prison. And do they now throw us out secretly? No. Let them come themselves and take us out." Okay, we was now we listen to verse 37's recording. I want to take you back to the book of Romans, chapter 13, verses 1 to 7. Please read it in your spare time. And it's about the authority given to governments. Now, Paul tells the citizens in Rome here to obey the government authorities, because the reason is God has established government to enforce good conduct and also a peaceful society. Now, obviously, not all governments don't do this. We have clear examples of those governments in today's societies that just do what they want and do what they pleases. Now, as Christians, we should obey any law that does not contradict what God tells us in the Bible. So, looking on the flip side of the coin, if the government breaks the law, its own laws, we should feel free to point this out to them and expect justice. It's our right to do that. Now, Paul and Silas are two clear examples, exact examples that performed this right. They were living peacefully, but not in secret. They actually, however, they demanded that the magistrates publicly and acknowledge their own injustice that they performed and apologize first. Now, it is perfectly acceptable for Christians to expect and demand that civil rights given to them by the secular government. Let's continue reading from verse 38. The police reported these words to the magistrates, and they were afraid when they heard that they were Roman citizens. So they came and apologized to them. And they took them out and asked them to leave the city. So they went out of the prison and visited Lydia. And when they had seen the brothers, they encouraged them and departed. Now, the crime the magistrates have committed seems to be a much greater legal offense than that of Paul and Silas. We see here that years later, a tribune of the Roman army will have seen the same response of fear when he realizes his troops have merely tied Paul up. In a future podcast, Acts 22 verse 29, but please go ahead and read. Paul and Silas are not vindictive people. All they want is they don't want to punish the magistrates. They just want a formal apology from them. And we see that eventually the magistrate comply to their requests. And Paul and Silas bid farewell to their hostess Lydia and they leave town. Acts 16 verse 39 to 40, which we've just read. Further on, Paul and Silas' time in Philippi shows that the believers' fluid relationship with the civil law. Now, when a law goes against God's instructions, such as a ban on the preaching of Jesus' salvation, offer of salvation, we are obliged to break it. Now, when our legal rights, like the right to a fair trial, are withheld, we are free to demand the law be fairly applied. It's our right to do it. At the same time, when we break a law, such as when illegally preaching Christ, we should expect to pay the cost. There's a law against that, and we break that law. Before we ask them to remove the law, we should be expect to take the cost, to pay the cost for that. And you see also that Paul and Silas are here only halfway through their missionary voyage. So there's quite a fair bit of trips for them ahead and more for us to explore and give you more wonderful experiences that these two men enjoyed and had. Now, from here, they will go to Thessalonica as their next stop. Now, that city has enough traditionally minded Jews. So, I think Paul and Silas didn't stay long there. These Jews really, I think, made it a short trip for them. Paul will flee to Athens, where he have the quintessential philosophical debate. According to Acts 17, that will be the next, our next podcast, verses 16 to 34. So please, if you want to read it in your free time. And you also meet up with the rest of the team in the Corinth, Acts 18, verses 1 to 17. Hi viewers, this brings us to the end of Acts 16. We certainly hope, for me and Margarita, that you enjoyed listening to us. Seeing what happened in the time of Acts and Paul's and Silas' travels, missionaries. I'm so glad we have the biblical scholars that researching this information through archaeological discoveries and research work to make it us, our work just so much easier to present to you wonderful and powerful presentations that you can use in your daily walk of Christ. Please share this information which we bring to you, to your family, your loved ones, to fellow Christians in your community, in your church, and live the Word of God. We hope that God will bless you. We hope that you will have a wonderful time The next week, week and two, we're looking forward to bring to you the next podcast in a couple of weeks. It will be Acts 17. Margarita is the one that's doing the researching, and I am the one and presenting and preparing it for you. May God bless you, and may He shine His face upon you and bestow His peace on you. We pray this to you in God's name. Shalom.